all the same which was told to them concerning this child. Amen. This is my Bible. God's holy word.
Is
a lamp unto my feet.
Light unto my path.
Grass withers.
Flowers
fade.
Word of our
God
shall
stand forever.
This is my
Bible.
This is my
weapon.
Sword of the Spirit.
Amen. I want to talk about divine interruption. Divine interruption. When the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, into the world. All things were ready. Roman Empire had established peace. It was called the Pax Romana. They had established peace in all of the known world. Greek was the common language spoken by people across the empire, which made communication easy across ethnic lines. The Romans had built roads across the empire for the purpose of moving their army swiftly to any city or province. But those roads also made it easy, easier for citizens to travel. The seas had been rid of pirates. So now, sea trade and travel were in their prime. And notwithstanding, the people were spiritually exasperated due to the multiplicity of gods and mystery cult religions of their time. So the people were now ready for the truth. And it was into this period and into this culture that God became incarnate to bring joy to the world. When the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, into the world. In our text, heavenly beings broke the silence of a dark Judean sky. They broke that silence with an announcement to some shepherds who were settling down for the night. Without a warning, midnight atmosphere was suddenly illuminated with the presence of an angelic being. The angel of the Lord appeared before the shepherds, and the glory of the Lord radiated from his being, surrounding the shepherds as they fell to the ground with great fear. Fear is the natural response, reaction to such a visitation. For such visits were believed to be those of judgment. However, to their joy and their surprise, this angel came not with words of judgment, but with a heavenly message of joy. Heavenly message of joy, fulfilling the words of all of the ancient prophets.
Yes, yes.
He spoke a word.
Yes, sir.
And he calmed their spoke and calmed their fears with words that they had longed and lived to hear. He said, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you this day in the city of David is born a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." This word was assuredly a divine interruption. God interrupted their mundane routine with a word, with a message of peace, hope, joy, and love. And such a message would no doubt calm every fear and confirm every faith. Divine interruptions, church, are heavenly orchestrated moments that bring into our private world for purposes of God that we either have been praying for or not even expecting. And since God is sovereign, He does not have to ask permission. But essentially, what He does is exercise His divine prerogative. And He interrupts our lives, as in this instance, and He does so for a greater good. And since He always has our best interests at heart, these interruptions come to make us better and not bitter in life. These interruptions are often confirmations to our long-awaited prayers and petitions that seem to be falling upon deaf ears. These interruptions can revive hope long deferred and ignite the flame of faith to burn hot again in our hearts. Can I get a witness? Yes. The divine interruption in this text was when the angel came to earth with good news of great joy. I told you before, if you are a Galizzo, make a scholar. Good news of great joy, of which the shepherds gladly received. And as if in a way of confirmation, the angel of the Lord was then accompanied by a heavenly host. The heavenly choir, the mass choir showed up and began praising God. I'm not making it up, is I? And singing, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." That silent night was transformed by this divine interruption. It no longer was calm, but all was bright. So how did those shepherds respond to this divine interruption? Well, to begin with, they received the proclamation. They opened their hearts. They opened their minds to receive the message sent to them from God. They recognized that the messengers of God were not proclaiming their own message, but rather they were proclaiming the message that had been given to them to deliver. And too often, we are guilty of dismissing the message, dismissing the truth that God sends to interrupt our routines and regimens because of our tendencies to reject any challenging and convicting truth. Or there are times in which we dismiss the message because of our questions, concerns, and even issues about or with the messenger. truthfulness of the text. The messenger may be indeed be flawed, but actually we all are flawed. But that does not invalidate the authenticity of the message given to be delivered to you. Even angelic beings have the propensity to sin, as some did and rebelled against God. But that predilection poses no barrier to God. God is only looking for willing vessels. Be they marred or flawed, he's just looking for some vessels who will carry the heavenly message to those who are longing to hear and who are on his interruption list. After this divine interruption of a proclamation, those shepherds were now filled with motivation. The word from God prompted them to take action. Their lives would never be the same, and as their hearts and as their hopes were now transformed. Listen to me. Hope deferred had now become a reality, as they would now seek for deeper truth and understanding of the scriptures that they knew and had read. And like these shepherds, church, to hear and receive the word of God should touch our hearts and give us the impetus to search the scriptures for truth and deeper truth to undergird and reinforce our faith. One writer said, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Our faith walk with God is personal, so it is incumbent upon each individual to seek deeper truths about God for themselves. You see, our faith in and relationship with God is non-transferable. Every man, every woman, we're going to have to stand alone before the judgment seat of Christ in order to give an account of the stewardship of this life. And we are called to be stewards of God's word, not just stewards of time and talent, not just being a good steward of your treasure, but a steward of that word. You ain't listening to me. Divine interruptions should motivate us to search the scriptures, to confirm what we have heard and believe about God, the Holy Spirit, and the Lord Jesus Christ. But that's not all that happened. Because next, this divine interruption, not only did they receive the proclamation and then have a little motivation, it prompted an investigation. For the angel told them where and what to look for. Right there in verse 11, he said, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. This point correlates with the previous one, motivation. For they were moved to seek confirmation of the proclamation. And they need, I'm not really trying to do all this alliteration, but that's just how it's rolling out. And see, they needed not only an expected, listen, I want you to get this. They needed not only an expectant faith, but also an experienced faith. See, expectant faith is anticipation. But experienced faith becomes your confirmation. See, many who have heard the proclamation, boy, I'm literate myself. Christ of experience. Yes, the proclamation was true, but they would have never experienced that truth for themselves if they had not been motivated to do some investigation. Now, could they have just heard the word and believed? Well, yes. But that would have not given them a personal testimony. See, then they could only tell others what was told to them and not be able to say that now they know for themselves. See, that word know, this speaks of experience. You know, they knew for a fact that the word spoken to them was true because they acted on it, they investigated, and then they experienced the truth of God's word in their own life. Are you listening to me? Yes, yes. You can't have secondhand religion. Yeah, I know it's real popular to have resale shops in here. Pick up some secondhand stuff that look pretty good. Some of that stuff still had the labels on it. Come on, ladies, say amen. And so, you know, that might work in the world. You can buy a used car. You can buy a house somebody else lived in. But I come to tell you, when it comes down to Jesus, you can't get it secondhand. You can't lease it. You got to know. You only heard that he's a way out of no way, but has he ever been your way out of no way? You only heard that he's bread that is starving the land, but has he ever made a way for you to eat and put food on your table when you didn't know it was coming from? And somebody say he's a shelter in the time of a storm, but have you ever been in a storm where you needed the Lord to seal you?
Who can write and divide the
contract. So you will know what's coming to you. Are you listening to me? And that's the same way it is with God's word. You just can't rely on me to tell you what's in there. You better get in the word and find out. From God that are yours to claim in your own life. Shame on you. If you hold in the contract, you had to take the time to read. Lord Jesus. Bible said you have not because you ask not. And if you never investigate the word of God, you will not even ever come into the knowledge even to what to ask for. You have not because you ask not, but you don't know what to ask for because you ain't looking in the word. But when you are willing, when you are willing to act upon what the word of God says, you will discover that God is a promise keeper. And if he says it, it's going to be exactly as he said. See, God promised us new hearts and desires. It's in the Bible. In Ezekiel 36 and 26, he said, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take that heart of stone out of your flesh and then give you a heart of flesh. God's promised forgiveness. I said it's in the Bible. 1 John 1 and 9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. God promises. And our sins will be far removed from us. Yeah. It's in the Bible. Yeah. In Psalm 103 and 12, it says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgression from us. Yeah. Yes, we have promised that our sins will be buried. Yeah. I said it's in the Bible. Yeah. Micah 7:19 says, he will again have compassion on us and will subdue our iniquities, and you will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. Yeah. I said, God promised, he's a promise keeper, that all our needs will be supplied. I said, it's right there in the Bible. But Paul said in Philippians 4:19, and my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Are you listening to me? I said, God promises to heal us and forgive us. Yes. It's in the Bible. Yes. In Psalm 103 it says, bless the Lord O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases. Yes. I said, God promises that he'll provide safety. Yes. It's in the Bible. In Proverbs 18:10 it says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. Yes. The righteous run to it and are saved. When you're willing, church, to act upon what the word of God says, you will discover that God is a promise keeper. Yeah. Now I want you to know that that confirmation gave him determination to share the good news. Because it says in verse 17, when they had seen it, then they made known abroad the saying, which was told them concerning the child. Yeah. Those shepherds couldn't keep it to themselves. You know, that's how it is when you come to discover the goodness of God. When you come to experience the promises of God in your life, oh, you can't keep it to yourself. Or you think you're telling something when you found a new place to shop. You think you're really telling something when you found a new place to dine. You think you're really telling something when you come across some breaking news and first to tweet it out. And I'll tell you, ain't any of that stuff compared to when the promises of God are fulfilled in your life. You get a chance to go and tell somebody that God is a promise keeper. Those shepherds couldn't keep it to themselves. The word of God rang true in their lives, and they couldn't keep it to themselves. They became living testimonies of the promises of God that they experienced in their own lives. And maybe it was from this verse that the hymn writer penned one day. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hill, and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain, y'all, that Jesus Christ is born. I want you to know that this divine interruption served as motivation for those shepherds that moved them to an investigation as to whether what was proclaimed was true. And their investigation of the word resulted in a confirmation, which gave them a determination to share the good news of great joy to all who were here. I don't know how you feel about it, but I thank God for divine interruption. I don't know about you this morning, but I thank God that He is a promise keeper. Boy, I want to thank God for every time that He decides to interrupt our routine for the word of inspiration for our failing faith. Yes, I don't know about you, but I want to thank God for every time that He decides to interrupt my routine with a word of confirmation for my hope that's been long deferred. And when this happens, we, like the shepherds, gotta go and tell somebody. Yes, when this happens, like the shepherds, we gotta go and tell somebody how great is our God. And I'm wondering, is there anybody here this morning that has ever had a divine interruption in your life? Yes, when you were waiting to hear a word from the Lord, when you were waiting for a prayer that seemed one night and one door to get an answer, but then, yes, one day, or maybe one night, way over in the midnight hour, God woke you up and gave you the answer. He shook you real easy and gave you the revelation. He shook you real easy and made the promise to you that He was going to answer your prayer. Do I have any prayer warriors that know that God will be able to answer your prayer? Can you thank Him for divine interruptions? Sometimes those interruptions, they seem like God has got you confused with somebody else. But is there anybody here that can say it looked like God was making a mistake? But I thank Him that He shut that door, and then He opened this door. He closed that gate and then made another way. Thank Him for divine interruption. Yeah, yeah. Now if you ain't too sure
that he was going to give a son. He promised that a child would be born, and that son and that child is named Jesus. And because he's a promise keeper, we have life eternal. We have everlasting life. And that's the best Christmas present you could ever get, is eternal life. Because it won't fade away. It won't be destroyed. It's forever.
But he always has our best interests at heart. Because he and he alone knows what tomorrow holds. Amen. We don't know what tomorrow holds. But you ought to thank God if you know the one who holds tomorrow. Amen. That's Jesus Christ.
Our Lord.
There may be someone today on this beautiful Christmas morning who want to give your life to Christ.